Pascal's triangle predicts the most important probability theorem. It tells us how to multiply x plus y to the 12th, and hidden within it are the powers of 2, a fractal, and the Fibonacci sequence. And it all starts from this simple pattern. We start with 1, and then the next row is 1, 1. Then the next row will start and end with 1, but for that value in the middle, we'll add up the two numbers above. We get 1 plus 1 is 2. You can imagine that the values that go beyond the edge of the triangle are all 0 if you want. For the next row, we start with 1, then we add 1 plus 2 to get 3, 2 plus 1 is also 3, and then we end with 1. If you continue this pattern, you get Pascal's triangle. Here's how Blaise Pascal drew this triangle in his treatise on the arithmetic triangle. Since the triangle is named after him, we can be sure of one thing. Others studied it before he did. About 6 centuries earlier in Persia, Al-Karaji and Omar Khayyam studied this triangle. And you might also hear it called Yonghui's triangle or Tartaglia's triangle. So why were so many mathematicians studying this pattern? To see how this relates to algebra, let's look at x plus y to the power 4. It's sort of tedious to multiply this all out, but we'll get x to the 4th plus 4x cubed y plus 6x squared y squared plus 4xy cubed plus y to the 4th. Does that look familiar? The coefficients match exactly with that row of Pascal's triangle. If we number the rows starting from 0, then it's row 4 that gives us these coefficients. And the other rows give the coefficients for the other powers of x. So why does this work? Let's look at x plus y squared. When we multiply this out, we have x times y, y times x, and y times y. This is all the different ways to pick either x or y from the first factor and x or y from the second factor. If we're interested in how many xy terms we're going to have, we can think about how many ways there are for us to pick one value of x and one value of y. Well, there's two ways, xy and yx. So we can write this number as 2 choose 1, since out of two possible factors, we're choosing 1 to be the x and the other will be y. This is called a combination or a binomial coefficient. Let's write down x plus y cubed without actually multiplying it all out. How many ways are there to get x cubed? Well, we'll have to pick x for each of the three factors. That's the only way we're going to get that. So we have 1x cubed. Now, what about x squared y? Out of three factors, we want to pick one to be a y and the others will be x. So there are three different factors we can pick to be the y, which gives us 3x squared y. For the other cases, we can repeat these same calculations, reversing x and y, and we get the same values. So what does all this have to do with Pascal's triangle? Let's think about x plus y to the 4th and see if we can figure out how many x squared y squared terms there will be. We have 4 different factors, and we want to pick 2 x's and 2 y's. So out of 4 factors, we choose 2 to be x's, 4 choose 2. We could just try to calculate this directly, but let's think about it another way. If we separate the last factor, then we have this group of 3 factors. If the last factor happens to be x, then there's only one remaining x for the group of 3. So out of those 3 factors, we pick 1 to be x. That's 3 choose 1, which is 3. But if the last factor happens to be y, then there will be 2 x's in the group of 3. So we get 3 choose 2. So what we've shown is that 4 choose 2 equals 3 choose 1 plus 3 choose 2. And that's exactly how Pascal's triangle works. The entry in the 4 choose 2 position is found by adding up 3 choose 1 and 3 choose 2. So Pascal's triangle is made up of binomial coefficients, and it illustrates the binomial theorem. To multiply a binomial, we can just grab the coefficients from that corresponding row of the triangle. Let's see how Pascal's triangle relates to probability and games of chance. Imagine a ball is dropped down this board. It hits this peg, and let's say it has a 50-50 chance of bouncing left or right. Maybe it bounces left and then hits this peg. Again, let's imagine it has a 50-50 chance of bouncing to the left or to the right. Maybe this time it goes to the right. If the board has 4 rows of pegs, then the ball will end up in one of these 5 slots. The probability of any specific sequence of moves, say left, right, right, left, is 1/2 times 1/2 times 1/2 times 1/2, which is 1/16. But there are multiple paths that will lead to the same slot. So how many different paths will lead the ball to this middle position? We need to bounce to the left twice and to the right twice. There's 4 different bounces, and we want to pick 2 of them to be to the left. and then the other two will go to the right. So this is the binomial coefficient 4 choose 2. It's just like multiplying out x plus y to the fourth. Each slot corresponds to one of the terms, and the number of paths to get to that slot are the coefficients. We can look at Pascal's triangle to see how many paths there are to each slot. There's 6 different paths to this middle slot, and they each have probability 1/16th, so the total probability is 6/16ths. And we can find all the other probabilities by changing the numerator to match Pascal's triangle. This is an example of a binomial distribution where there's a 50-50 chance for each trial. The probabilities for the final results are the entries of the nth row of Pascal's triangle, all divided by 2 to the n. If we graph these values, we get the shape of the probability mass function for this binomial distribution. Even if you use the values directly from Pascal's triangle, this will just scale the graph, so it still has the same shape. As we go farther down Pascal's triangle, the values in the row look more and more bell-shaped. This gives the first step of the central limit theorem, which is perhaps the most important probability result. It shows us that the binomial distribution is becoming more and more like a normal distribution as n goes to infinity. Each time the ball hits a peg, it has a 50-50 chance of moving left or right. It's essentially completely unpredictable. But if we view the ball's entire trip, we can make meaningful predictions about where it will end up. The central limit theorem applies not just to these binomial distributions, but also to a much wider class of distributions. It's at the heart of a lot of statistical analysis, and it shows us how random events over time can form predictable patterns. This essential result is hidden in plain view in Pascal's triangle. Many other features are hidden as well. We saw in the binomial distribution, the probabilities are the entries in Pascal's triangle divided by 2 to the n. These probabilities must sum to 1, so the row in Pascal's triangle must add up to 2 to the n. This makes sense since each value in a previous row contributes twice to the row below it, so the sum of each row should be double the sum of the previous row. Row 1 has sum 2, which is 2 to the 1. Then we double this value to get the sum of the next row, and so on. The Fibonacci sequence also shows up. This is the famous sequence that starts with 1, 1. Then each following value is the sum of the previous two. The next number is 2, and then 3, then 5, and so on. It's a little easier to see the sequence in Pascal's triangle if we left align its values like this. Now we add up the values along the diagonals. We get 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, and so on. It's the Fibonacci sequence. So why did this show up? Imagine you're playing a game where you want to move to the right on a board. Each turn, you can decide to move one space to the right, or you can hop two spaces to the right. If you want to move to the right 4 spaces, there are 3 ways to do this. You can take 4 single moves, you can take 2 singles and 1 double, or you can take 2 doubles. So how many different ways are there to make each of these patterns? If we make 4 single moves, there are no doubles to take. So out of 4 turns, we choose 0 of them to be doubles. If we make 2 single moves and 1 double, that's 3 total turns, and we have to choose one of those to be the double. 3 choose 1. And if we make 2 double moves, then that's 2 turns, and they're both doubles, so that's 2 choose 2. We see that these combinations are precisely the values along one of these diagonals of Pascal's triangle. Now we just have to see why would that equal the sum of the previous 2 diagonals. This is because every path that moves 4 spaces comes from one of 2 distinct possibilities. The last move is either a single step that starts from space 3, or it's a double step that starts from 2. And the previous 2 diagonals count the paths to get to space 2 and space 3. So if we add up those previous 2 diagonals, then that will give us the value of this diagonal. And that's exactly how the Fibonacci sequence is defined. And Pascal's triangle even turns into a fractal. Let's color each number black if it's odd and white if it's even. This is an approximation of Sierpinski's triangle. The farther we go in Pascal's triangle, the closer we get to the fractal. And in the limit, as the row n goes to infinity, the picture is exactly Sierpinski's triangle. To see why this happens, we can start with row 0 and 1 of Pascal's triangle. Then we'll construct the following rows like we normally do, but the only values we can use are 0 and 1 for even and odd. So when we add 1 plus 1, we get an even value, which we write as 0. The first four rows form a triangle made up of three copies of the smaller triangle and has zeros in between those copies. If we continue for four more rows, then that larger triangle is now copied three times with zeros in the middle. And the farther we go, the more times this pattern will iterate, giving us a better and better approximation of Sierpinski's triangle. For over 1,000 years, humanity has explored this simple arithmetic triangle for its deep connections to algebra, probability, fractals, and more. And of course, there's many more patterns and secrets hiding in Pascal's triangle. Let us know what patterns you uncover in the comments, and subscribe for more videos like this one. Thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you next time.